In today's video, I'll guide you through the simplest way to create a Raylib C++ application for Android. Take a look at this. Our classic ball example is now running smoothly on an Android device. Isn't that awesome? The first step is downloading and installing Android Studio. Android Studio is a development environment used to build Android apps. While it mainly supports Java and Kotlin, Android Studio also lets you write C and C++ code using the native development kit, NDK, which we will be using. Download Android Studio and the Android NDK from the SDK manager within the IDE after installation. I won't cover the installation of Android Studio and the NDK as there are many excellent tutorials online. Instead, I'll provide a link to a step-by-step video. Make sure to check it out before we proceed. If your Android Studio is set up, we can build our first Raylib Android app. We will be using Raymob, a fantastic project that makes the entire procedure extremely easy. Raymob simplifies the setup process for Raylib on Android, allowing us to focus more on writing code and less on the configuration details. We have to visit the GitHub repository of the project and download it like this. Before leaving the repository, give it a star, because it makes our life so much easier. It is our way of thanking the developer for sharing his work with us. Now we have to unzip the file we downloaded. I will unzip it to the desktop. Let's rename the folder we unzipped to something else. I'll name it Ball Example. Now let's open the project with Android Studio. In this dial box, we can see the project I am already working on. By the way, you can check out my Android games here. My most popular one is named Quiz of Knowledge, with over 9 million downloads. I think you will like it. In this dialog box, we have to click on the Open Project button. Now we have to navigate to the desktop and open the Ball Example project. Now our project is open and we are ready to work on it. Android Studio might show us some pop-up windows. One of them is asking us to upgrade the Android Gradle plugin. Don't upgrade it now because it can lead to build errors. If Android Studio and the NDK are configured correctly, the project will start syncing. This process can take a little while. This is because Android Studio needs to download and configure all the necessary dependencies in the background. So don't worry if it feels like it is taking forever. This is totally normal. Once the procedure finishes, we should be good to go. Let's see the code of the project. We have to click on the app folder and navigate to the CPP subfolder, and then again select the CPP subfolder. Inside this folder, we can see two important files, a .c file and a cmakelists.txt file. The cmakelists.txt file is a configuration file used by CMake, a build system that helps us compile and link our C++ code for Android. This file tells Android Studio how to handle the C++ code in our project. It specifies which source files to compile, which libraries to link, and how to generate the final executable for our app. It is like a set of instructions that guide the build process for native code. So every time we want to make changes to our C++ code or add new libraries, we may need to update this file to reflect those changes. Now let's take a look at the .c file in our project, which contains the actual code of our Raylib application. This is a very basic example that displays a text on the screen. Cool, let's run it. To do that, we have two options. We can either use an Android emulator or a physical device. If you want to use an emulator, Android Studio has built-in support for it. All you need to do is to go to the Android Virtual Device Manager, which lets you create and manage emulators for various Android devices. You can set up an emulator that mimics a real device, choosing the screen size, Android version, and more. Once your emulator is set up, just hit the Run button in Android Studio, and your app will launch on the virtual device. Keep in mind that running the emulator for the first time might take a bit of time as it initializes everything, but after that, it should run more smoothly. On the other hand, if you prefer to test on a physical device, simply connect your Android phone or tablet to your computer via USB. Make sure that developer options and USB debugging are enabled on your device. You can find these settings under the Developer Options menu, which you can enable by tapping the build number in your phone settings multiple times. Once that's done, Android Studio should recognize your device automatically. Then, just like with the emulator, hit the Run button and your app will launch directly on your device. Both methods will yield the same results, so choose the option that works best for you. I will use the emulator for now, so let's click here. As you can see, the emulator is loading. Fast forward a few seconds and our first Raylib application is running and it displays a text message on the screen. Cool. It was easy, wasn't it? Now let's press this button to stop the application from running. Now let's modify this project and create our familiar bouncing ball C++ example. First, let's delete the main.c file. We need to right-click on the file, select refactor, and then click on the save delete option. The main.c file is now deleted. Next, let's download the sample bouncing ball example project from this repository and unzip it somewhere on our computer. This C++ Raylib project displays a bouncing ball inside a window. The project consists of three files, the main.cpp, ball.h, and ball.cpp. I can hear you asking, Nick, why does this simple project use three files instead of just one? The reason for using three files is that this project follows object-oriented programming principles, which help organize the code in a cleaner and more modular way. Instead of putting everything into one file, we separate the logic into different files, each with its own responsibility. If you are new to object-oriented programming, don't worry. I have created a course that makes object-oriented programming easy to understand. In this course, we will not only build a very interesting example, an artificial life simulator, but we will also learn object-oriented programming in a way that really sticks. Although the course is in Python, the concepts are very similar to C++, so you will be able to apply what you learn in your C++ project as well. For the next 15 days, I'm offering a 50% discount on the course as a one-time offer, so it's the perfect opportunity to dive in and master object-oriented programming. Be sure to check it out. The link is in the description below. Now let's get back to the project. Let's copy all three files and paste them inside the CPP folder. Now we need to make some modifications. First, let's modify the cmake_lists.txt file. We need to add our source files so that cmake knows which files to compile. To do this, we will append our source files to the sources variable. So in this line of code, we add the following four lines. List, parentheses, append sources, quotes, dollar, curly brackets, cmake source dir / main.cpp, quotes, dollar, curly brackets, cmake source dir / ball.h, quotes, dollar, curly brackets, cmake source dir / ball.cpp. Now that we have updated our cmake_lists.txt file, we can save it and sync our project in Android Studio by pressing this button. This step is crucial as it allows CMake to regenerate the build files with our new configuration. Cool, now we can open the main.cpp file. We need to make some changes here as well. In the first line of the code, we need to include raymob.h instead of raylib.h. This change is essential because raymob.h provides the necessary functionality tailored for Android development, allowing us to access Android-specific features like the accelerometer, soft keyboard, and other device capabilities. Next, let's remove the screen width and screen height variables. Instead of specifying fixed dimensions for the window, we will pass 0 for both width and height in the initWindow function. This change allows our application to automatically adjust and fill the entire screen, providing a more immersive experience. If needed, we can retrieve the actual screen width and screen height using Raylib functions like getScreenWidth and getScreenHeight. This way, we maintain flexibility in our layout while ensuring that our application adapts to various device sizes. We are all set to run our code, and there it is, a bouncing ball appearing perfectly on the emulator screen. Now, let's test it on a physical device. Check this out. It works flawlessly. The ball bounces just as expected. If you found this video helpful, please give it a thumbs up. Your support helps more people discover this easy procedure and learn how to create their own Android Raylib projects. Also, let me know your thoughts in the comments below. I would love to hear about your experiences with Raylib and Android development. Do you want more Android tutorials with Raylib? Thanks for watching. Make sure to subscribe to my channel for more awesome programming tutorials. See you in the next video.